Well, basically, we are not data scientists or data engineers. We come from the city planning domain and the human geography domain. But we are using big data and geographical information science to advance the sophistication of spatial accessibility analysis and support healthcare practitioners and urban planners in delivering more sustainable and people-oriented healthcare solutions. So what is spatial accessibility? We can define it as the potential for interaction or the ease to reach desired opportunities. In the healthcare domains, accessibility refers to the interaction between the location of people, the location of a healthcare service, and the transport system connecting the people with the services. It's a very useful framework because it helps us to identify areas with the shortage of physician of healthcare service, and to allocate health and financial resources to those needy area in order to alleviate accessibility problem. And last but not least, accessibility is also a widely accepted key goal and a human right according to the United Nations. So what's wrong with current accessibility analysis? Basically, they provide a static picture of accessibility. This means that they neglect that people location changes during the day, that transport performances changes during the day, and also that healthcare provision can change during the day. We can make some example. I'm now here making this presentation. Maybe in a couple of hours I will be, I don't know, in the city center having a beer, and later on my position will change again. At the same time, when we wait for the bus, sometimes we wait 3 minutes, sometimes 10 minutes, and so on. Because during the day, the frequencies and the schedules can change. And also the health provision change, because some facilities open at a certain hour and close to other hours, or the number of doctors working in the same facility may change during the day. So basically, as these three elements are dynamic, we can say that accessibility is dynamic. In order to test this hypothesis, so we collect data from different sources. Some are more traditional sources, like demographic or cadastral data, but we also collect geolocated tweets and transit data from Google Transit. And we built a model to simulate the fluctuation in healthcare accessibility. So about healthcare facilities opening hour, here in this map we can see the city of Madrid, and the red point represents specialized healthcare facility in the city. These are all the healthcare facility, but if we analyze the situation during the early morning, for instance between 8 and 9, when some of these facilities are open, we have a certain service areas. But the situation changes if we analyze it at lunchtime, and we see that are new open facilities, and the situation changes again if we analyze it in the late afternoon, because some facilities are closed and some are still open. So what about variation in transit performance? We know that transit performances fluctuates during the day due to variation in schedules and frequency. So what we did, we used GTFS data. Sometimes they are also called Google data because they are the data that feeds Google Maps or Google Transit application. And we built our dynamic and multimodal transport network. With this transport network, we calculate travel time from each point of the city to the closest facility at each minute of the day. And then we average this result along predefined time periods. For instance, we can see an example in a time period between 6 a.m. and 9 a.m. Sorry. And for variation in population location, and now we explain how we did it.
Well, can I talk like this? No, because I'm too short for this. Well, what we did was to compute where people are at different times of the day in different parts of the city. As Gennaro just said, we are very used to compute accessibility in a static way, but we know that we move. If you consult the traditional data sources, for example, the census, then we can know where people are at night, what's the place of residence. But obviously, most people, we move during the day, and if we have very good access from our home, but we spend 10 or 8 or 10 hours a day at work, maybe we are more interested in to have a good accessibility from our workplace or from a leisure area during the weekend, etc. So what we did was, we're doing, indeed this is work in progress, is to combine several data sources. First, we have the census of population, of course, it's a good and reliable data source, so we know where people live. Then we compare that with the cadastral information, so we can know the places of work, because with the cadastral data, we can know where are the offices, where are the educational centers, where do we have commerce. But in addition to that, we want to know also the intensity of the use. And for that, sorry. Like this? Thanks. So with the intensity, with geolocated tweets, we made an approach to know what's the intensity of use during the day of the different parts of the city. For example, it's not only that we know where the offices are, but we need to know also if it's a very big one with a lot of people attending there, or if it's a place that is mainly used only during the morning and not in the afternoon. Of course, we know about some drawbacks of this approach, but by combining several databases, we can at least have quite a good proxy. And well, of course, we can do this at different times of the day. If it's in the early morning, people have not reached the city center yet. And in the midday, there are much more people in the city center, mainly working. And then at the, in the evening, we can see that the city center is much more populated. So what we were interested in was to combine the effects of the healthcare opening hours that Gennaro explained, the public transport performance, and also the different the location of population during the day. With this, this is the, what we typically would get if we apply a typical accessibility measure, that we just have a picture for the study area, and we don't know exactly when it corresponds. If it is the average of the day, if it's in the morning, if it's an average hour that mainly doesn't correspond to any particular hour. One improvement consists into providing some smarter solutions, so we can have different accessibility index in the morning, in the afternoon, or in the evening. In here, what you can see in green are the areas with the best accessibility. For, this means that you have larger opportunities with lower travel time and with fewer people competing with you to get an appointment in the doctor. Whereas the red areas means that you have a bad combination of long travel time, to the area, to the healthcare center. The health center maybe doesn't have much doctors, and or there are a lot of people that also go to the same doctor as you go. And we have that for the morning, in the mid, during the day, and also, of course, the same we have for the evening. And just to conclude and to give you time to ask some questions if you have, well, what we mean is that we have jumped from the static analysis to the dynamic one, and this is mainly with the use of big data that we can do this. Just the GTFS files that Gennaro was mentioning, also the geolocated tweets and any other source that we... I wish we had access to mobile phone data, for example, that covers a larger population than geolocated tweets. But in just with this, we were able to deliver a smarter and more sustainable healthcare strategies for the planning practitioners. From this, we think that it will be easier for them to plan soft planning measures. This means that they are cheaper and easier to apply. For example, if you think instead of building a new healthcare center, maybe you just need to adapt the opening hours to fit the user needs at this particular location, or adapt the transit frequencies so same population can, or more people can reach to a healthcare center within a reasonable travel time. And well, I think this is a relevant contribution to connect the studies, what we do at the academia, with the business and also with the administration. And we are very thankful to, with this forum, that, because sometimes we only explain this in the academic area. And I think that this is a very good occasion for sharing with you. And well, just to end, I would like to highlight that we have received some funding from Comunidad de Madrid and from the European funding in this project called Social Big Data, which promotes the collaboration between several, between these multidisciplinary groups in the academia and also with public administration and companies. So if you want to contact us, you have our emails over there, or you can contact me now and afterwards and see what else can we do. Thanks.
Thank you.
Questions? Or later.
Yeah, I would like to know, you show in your maps that there's really quite a big area, actually kind of around here, that is badly communicated with hospitals. Have you checked if that corresponds to, I mean, as you have obtained your data from census and a lot of sources, that actually corresponds with what people are doing, like traveling to all those hospitals that are far away?
Well, actually in Madrid, you can choose which hospital do you want to go. We don't have that data of which hospital each person picks, but what we're showing here is like the potential. Not the actual movements, but the potential. Because if you work there and you see that you have a good accessibility to a healthcare center and it's not the one that you are using, you might consider to change. And this way, all the system benefits, because you change to one that is better for you and you leave room in another one that maybe was more congested and was better for another person. Over there.
Hi, if I have understood you correctly, you have used static data and the geolocated Twitter data. But I think that it depends a lot on the job, the concrete job that each person has, because there are some jobs where you can't be tweeting all the time, and there are other jobs, and you may be on holiday at the city center of Madrid, and you may be tweeting all the time. So I'm not sure if it's there's not a great bias in the results.
Well, of course, there would be a bias, because when you are working with social science, there is always a bias. But we are also using a third data source, that is the cadastral information. With that source, we know if it's offices, if it's retail, if it's leisure, restaurants like that, if it's education. So at least we can better classify those spaces. If we see that there are a place without tweets and we see that it's industry, okay, we know that usually workers in a big industry can't be with the phone, but we have that part covered. Think that in the census, with the bias is much is larger, because you are only targeting people that remain at home. And on the other side, by combining the three data sources, okay, we have people that remain at home. Think, for example, old population, that we don't only have the location, but also the age of the people living in that part of the area. Old people generally don't tweet so much, but we know where they are. Okay, so we keep that area that you need high accessibility all the day long. But for the people that are working, we use Twitter not as the, it's the last layer of information that we add, and it's just to show the intensity of the use. It's a proxy, of course, it has many bias and many things, but when you combine millions of geolocated tweets, at the end you see that it makes sense and it's reproducing the general movement within the city. So we are improving what's been done until now, but of course there's room for much more improvement. For example, using phone data is much better than using Twitter, but Twitter is free for download, and mobile phone data is very hard to get, even if you had a small budget. And we are a public university, so we don't have a very high budget, but of course we're open to collaboration. Thank you.
Thank you.